bag and the fur around the pockets, and you got a wet and grabby pocket up here by your breast and that, you know? And they look really horrible. Because, like, if you look at these, see,
your
most of the ones around here all got them all on, you know, ex-army. They used to be, what's his name, illegal to buy, you know? And so I suppose that's why they bought them, you know, and they put their own fur in. And then another company brought out fur partners with red lining and everything, you know what I mean?
What about all the badges you're wearing the first time round? Mods absolutely never wore badges or anything like that.
Yeah, well, you ain't got to follow it to the button, have you? You know what I mean? I mean, you set new trends and mix it with the 60s as well. That's how it is.
The 79 mods have none of the individuality which distinguished the look the first time round. Today, being a mod is largely a matter of wearing the right uniform. Parkas, sports shirts, hush puppies or sneakers, plus a display of the right kind of badges. This conformity is partly because made-to-measure tailors are really expensive, but it's also a reflection of the fact that the new mods are mostly unemployed and just can't afford the old mod gear. And like the clothes, the new mod sound is a rougher, less sophisticated version of the prototype. The Purple Hearts, and it's hard to deny that if they'd been around 2 years ago, they would have been happy with the punk label. And it's clear from talking to the audiences at mod gigs that the majority of them were punks themselves up to the end of last year. So is the mod revival just the latest stage in the development of punk? Like the early days of punk, the mod scene has produced amateur fanzines, sold mainly at gigs like this one at the Wellington Pub near Waterloo. First of the batch was Maximum Speed, and as far as the people involved with the magazine are concerned, mod is something new and exciting and not just a rehash of punk.
Basically, I know myself and my friends as well were really not very happy with the way punk was going. It was getting too commercialised and it was too Chelsea set, and that's basically the thing that we weren't very happy about. So now with mods we feel much more at home with our mates, the blokes we go to football with, and they're just people who we will go about with anyway, and we feel really happier being mods than anything else.
Mods started more sort of like in North and East London. Punks were sort of becoming a real West London chic thing. And so it sort of started from below this rather than above. That's why, you know, people say it's just another extension of punk, ain't true.
Yeah, the thing that annoys us really more than anything else is the fact that punk got this tag as being working class, unemployment, dull queue rock, whereas most of the main punks or the geezers who were in the top punk bands were at art college and lived in really cushy homes in Surrey and Sussex and things like that.
Commissioners.
I mean, when people were punks, you'd have people who were normally bank clerks or something, who had quite short hair, but to go out on a punk night out would just put a load of Vaseline in their hair and they'd pretend they're on the dole, but really they're bank clerks. I mean, anyone who says they're a mod now and says, oh, I work in a bank, no one cares. So what? I mean, it's the way you get your money. You're still who you are, you know.
Do you think that the word mod's a bit unfortunate if it's applied to what you're all involved in? I mean, because you use the word mod, it makes me want to say to you, why aren't you more like the original ones? I mean, why haven't you chosen a different name?
Yeah, I mean, everyone seems to think it's so manufactured that we've taken this culture and we've got to do this, dress like this, do that. It's not a case of that at all. I think it comes down to there's a sort of a youth culture which believes in sort of dressing smartly, listening to a certain type of music, which has gone back from the early mods, gone all the way through skinheads, punks to a certain extent, and now it's come back to people who are calling themselves mods again. They listen to black music, they wear smarter clothes, they're just the opposite of sort of the rockers or the grease.
The people involved with Maximum Speed have been moving towards the mod image for over a year, well before the Quadrophenia movie went into production. Like the other mods we talked to, they are awaiting the film's release with a mixture of anticipation and dread.
You don't think that being a mod's just another thing after being a new...
Quadrophenia's going to end all that, isn't it?
What do you think will happen when it's...
It's going to commercialise it, and you're going to get all the shops like the punk shops, and all the little kiddies following on. They only know about the jam, you know, some of these, and yeah, it's going to end it all, you know? I mean, it's getting too big now, you know?
Are lots of shops selling mod clothes now?
Well, I don't know about that. There's one up there, Carnaby Cabin, who do the jam suits. Like £750,000 for a suit, you know what I mean?
So in a way, it's already going the way that punk went.
I can see it going that way, yeah.
So what do you feel about Quadrophenia? Are you sorry that
they made... I'm dying to go and see it, like. I'm dying to go and see it, but it's going to end it all, and we all know that, you know? They're going to go and see it, come out, buy new parkers, you know, try and get a scooter if they can, end up on push bikes, you know, end it all, you know?
Be massive by the time Quadrophenia's not coming out to October anyway. It will just be a resurgence then, because mods will pick up. It's always been likely to pick up in the summer because everyone's going to be down at Brighton and places like that. So it's going to be big before Quadrophenia. Quadrophenia can't really be given any credit for making it big. If you're going to give any credit to the start of mods, really, it's got to be the jam.
Yeah.
Because it's from the jam that people started dressing in suits, and from that they sort of started thinking, right, we're dressed smart instead of punky. And from that's where mods are coming.
Everything about the jam, from the guitars they play to their hairstyles, is based on mid-60s British music and fashion. Many former punks see them as the only new wave band who haven't sold out, and that's why lots of them have joined the mod bandwagon. But although it's a genuine grassroots movement, does mod really have a future? In the last 12 months alone, we've seen in quick succession rockabilly, merseybeat and skinhead revivals. What's to stop the mod movement being replaced equally swiftly by yet another revival? You'll be
betrayed by your essence and manners. But don't you think that the whole mod thing will just be replaced by something else? Maybe even flower power?
Yeah, probably.
I mean,
yeah, we've got this little theory about every 15 years, yeah. So, you know.
It's a complete recycling of what.
In a couple of years' time, everyone will be going around with sort of beads and that.
Yeah.
When they're trying to start
seriously, do you think the mod thing will be replaced by something else? It'll just be phased out?
It's got difficult to say at this stage because, really, you've got on it quite early. I mean, mod really hasn't been going for much longer than about 6 months in any sort of scale. Consequently, it's difficult to say what's going to happen, if anything is going to replace it. Mod's the only thing that I've ever really felt at home with, let's say. Consequently, there's no way that I'm immediately going to start growing my hair and wearing beads. So, if mod phases out, then that'd be it for me. I don't think people would immediately start becoming something else just because it's a fad, because mod really is something quite important.
The success or failure of the mod revival, like so many others, depends ultimately on the quality of the bands. And this is one of the biggest differences between the mods of 64 and their present versions. Back then, groups like the Chords and the Purple Hearts would have been left alone to develop their potential in small clubs. But in 1979, they're already being chased by a music press desperate to launch a new craze. All the signs are that the second mod era will be killed off by people anxious to make money out of it before it really gets started.